sponsors. And just to tell you about the festival, why are we so thankful to our sponsors? Because we are a not-for-profit organization, and without that kind of support, we would not be able to exist. We don't sell merchandise every day, the way, for instance, the straw would. So the festival is in its fourth day. We started on Wednesday night. We're going until Sunday night. I hope that you guys will come back tomorrow and see some more panels here. Go see some movies that are everywhere in Woodstock and Rhinebeck and Rosendale and Kingston and Saugerties. And meet the filmmakers. We have so many incredible filmmakers from all over, including the two that I'm about to bring soon, who came here from Canada. So before I bring them, if you have any electronic devices, just put them on silence, please. And now, the Woodstock Film Festival offers special awards each year. We're giving the Honorary Mavic Award, and we're giving the Honorary Fiercely Independent Award. They're kind of similar. They both really are about singular creativity. It's about doing film your own way, paving the way, being bold, being visionary. And I think that applies to both filmmakers I'm about to bring out here. One is from one side of the country, the other is from another. One is from Toronto, the other is from Winnipeg. They're both Canadian, and I'd like to bring Guy Maddin and Atom Egoyan up here, as well as the moderator, Charlie Keel. Come on up. There's Guy. And Atom. Oh, okay. And what about? I think I've been kissed enough. So I'm not gonna wash my face. So I'm going to hand the microphone now to Charlie Keel, who is going to moderate this conversation for you. So thank you, Charlie, for being here.
It's a particular pleasure to be able to host this panel because I've known both of these fine gentlemen for a number of years. Atom and I go way back, probably longer back than either of us would want to admit, but we were both undergraduate students at the University of Toronto at the same time. We were both film reviewers, and rather than content himself with merely saying how others' work wasn't good enough, Atom has obviously gone on to prove how good work can be. Guy I met later, and we've had the pleasure of having both Atom and Guy be instructors at the University of Toronto, and Guy's particular brand of personal whimsy and I want to say calculated outrage, but I think he would beg to differ, is always a pleasure to have around. So I think I'll just start some of these questions I'm going to ask Guy and Atom to sort of reflect not only on their own work, but on their one person's work vis-a-vis the other. Because they both occupy particular positions within the context of the Canadian filmmaking landscape. They're both definitely what we would call independent filmmakers. One could make the case that in Canada there's little else, but the kind of independence they represent, I think, is quite distinct. So I think I'm going to begin with that idea and ask each filmmaker to talk about the notion of independence as it relates to his work and how that notion has shaped and animated his career. And maybe we'll just start with Adam.
Well, around the time that we were students at U of T, there were two forms of production in Canada. One was primarily through the National Film Board and CBC, these sort of institutional forms. And then there was the tax shelter films. And the tax shelter films were these largely forgotten crop of films that were made for all the wrong reasons. Films that were made as tax write-offs for very rich people, and were kind of cobbled together and, you know, saw a whole plethora of forgotten American stars come north to lead these quite atrocious productions. I mean, there were good films that were made in that era, but for the most part, they're largely forgotten. And as a student, you know, watching this and wanting to be a filmmaker, I realized that there was no real model as to how to do it. besides just doing it yourself, you know, if one didn't want to go through the National Film Board route, which again is a more, there was an ideology behind that. There was a type of film that we all saw in high schools, the kind of the documentary tradition of filmmaking, neorealist sort of influenced, or there were these really awful features. And so there was no model, and we had to kind of, or I felt I had to create my own way of making films. And I was looking at, when we were writing reviews, I mean, one of the most strongest impressions, I remember very clearly interviewing Charles Burnett, who had a feature called Killer of Sheep. And it was around the same time that John Sayles was there with Return of Secaucus 7, which was also at the Toronto Film Festival. And those were really important influences. There was also a filmmaker, I don't know what happened to Victor Nunez, who had a film called Gal Youngin, which was also a film that he made in Florida for a very, very small amount of money. And these were the first independent films that I saw and had contact with. There were, of course, before that, the John Cassavetes and the people who were, and the Louis Bunuels, like way before that, and the whole American, you know, the Maya Darrens and these people that, at the University of Toronto, we could see prints at the time. Even though I wasn't studying film as such, I had access to this remarkable collection of films, and I saw, these American independents. But in terms of narrative feature, I would say it was Cassavetes and those filmmakers that I just mentioned. And after that, there was people like Rob Nielsen, and those films that were being made on the West Coast. So I realized that I had to do it on my own terms, and there was, fortunately, at the U of T, there was a club that allowed me to start making shorts, and then I started applying for grants, for these ultra low budget films, Canada Council, Ontario Arts Council. There was no, I'm not coming from a place where we had a private means, so it was always looking for grant money and incredible favors from friends. Since I didn't go to film school, I connected with actually Ron Mann, who was another person who was very influential to me, and actually why I'm here, because he insisted that this was a great festival, and it is. But he was making films at U of T, and so I saw him make documentaries like Poetry in Motion, Imagine the Sound. So he was the first practicing filmmaker that I was inspired by. And he told me if I wanted to do this, I had to connect with other filmmakers, and told me to go to Ryerson, hang out at the Ryerson Film School, which is where I met a lot of my early collaborators. So that's how I started.
Hi, Guy.
Hello. I didn't know anything. I've known you for 29 mm-hmm. years, and I never was too self-centered to ask you how you started.
You were always very narcissistic, yeah.
Yeah.
You always just told me how you started.
I'm going to tell you again. But you mentioned Canadian Tax Shelter, which a few years before I was even aware that I might even want to make movies, late 70s. But I found out recently, because I have this lost film project, that the Tax Shelter years, it's kind of like, it actually operated that you wanted to lose money on these movies, right? So it was like Mel Brooks, the producers. It's
very much like
you literally did. And there's a lost one because I was researching lost movies. Probably no one cared whether they were kept or not. But there is one called Creature of Comfort that's lost, and it was apparently about a carnivorous blanket that would eat the people that it was keeping warm while they slept at night. Anyway. It's lost, but I was determined to reshoot it.
And you could be sure that Lee Majors was in it, right?
Like that, exactly, yeah. That guy just made the tax shelter rounds. Anyway, I started probably a little later than you, but I was in my mid-20s. You seem to already have 7 features out by mid-20s. It's so annoying. I was just telling when Adam didn't show up until just a few minutes before.
He is here.
He's here now. We were theorizing that I might have to pretend to be Atom Egoyan, and I just suddenly realized I'm really sick and tired of not being Atom Egoyan. Just had just about enough of not being Atom Egoyan. It's about time I was Atom Egoyan. And then he showed up. Anyway, I lived in Winnipeg, which is this really isolated city. And I'm a self-isolating person within that city, so it didn't even occur to me that movies could be made in my city. I thought they just came from somewhere else. They came out of the TV or something like that, or out of theaters, and where they came from in the theatrical distribution world, I had no idea. They were just things I went to see now and then. But then I met a guy, a local filmmaker in the early 80s named John Pays, and he made movies from scratch, and they were highly artificial, a little bit like George Cuchar or John Waters movies, but really with his own DNA. But he made them in Winnipeg with an all-Winnipeg cast, and they were a little worlds unto themselves, and they were extremely entertaining, and I was overwhelmed by the very fact that they existed, but also by how good and engaging they were. And I guess I suddenly just opened up to underground cinema right away. Now there is, when I think about what independent cinema is, there could be nothing more independent than just a Winnipeg film circuit where the films are just playing in people's basements,
yeah,
or maybe in a classroom at a high school or in a gym or something. And that was what I discovered. After that, I joined the Winnipeg Film Group, but it was more of the same. The Winnipeg Film Group didn't have a distribution desk like it does now. It has a desk where there was a distributor sitting at it now. It sends films out into the world, or sends links or something like that. But and I met other filmmakers there. Their films I never loved as much as John Pays's, but eventually it became plausible that if I just kept copying John Pays in every aspect of his life, I too could become a filmmaker. And so a few years later, I was living with his girlfriend and using a camera he'd lent me and I never returned, and you know, using his film vocabulary. But I'm a terrible plagiarist. So the relationship with his girlfriend eventually ended, and I ended up making movies that were more like my own. But they had one thing in common with his. They were completely artificial and full of their maker's own obsessions and things like that. But it didn't even occur to me. I finally completed one. It took me a few years because filmmaking's expensive. I had no idea how much it would cost. I went out and shot for the first couple days and then just promptly ran out of money. Couldn't afford to process the film or anything, and I didn't have a plan B. And so it took me a few years to finish that film, and then I just expected some sort of local fame. And someone suggested that I send the film to the Toronto Film Festival, which is, I think, back then in 1986 was already enormous, probably the biggest film festival in the Western Hemisphere, right? And it's the second biggest film festival in the world after Cannes, and in many, I don't know how you define biggest, but the Winnipeg Film Group suggested I send my first film, The Dead Father, to the Toronto Film Festival. That's where I met Adam in 1986. In those pre-internet days, the people at the Winnipeg Film Group just looked up the dates of the Toronto Film Festival. But they used the previous year's calendar, so they had the wrong dates. And I decided, even though I'd made just a short film, I decided to go for the whole 10 days of the festival. And but the dates were wrong, and so I was there for only 4 days of the festival. I did meet Adam. He was very sweet. But I wandered around the streets of Toronto, bored out of my head and depressed, and finally just weeping on a street corner during a heavy downpour. And Adam remembered meeting me a week before and watched me, just watching the lights, you know, as I was telling you just a few minutes ago, watching the lights turn from green to amber to red. He says now 18 cycles he watched me. I didn't have any one direction to go to, so I didn't just stood there, and he rescued me and took me in. And I learned about the, and talked to me very patronizingly. while I dried out, and I learned from him about what independent filmmaking is about, and the rest is what he just told you.
So, since you've alluded to the Toronto Film Festival, I wonder if both of you could speak to the importance of not simply TIFF, but the idea of an institution of the film festival to the development and fostering of careers such as your own. So, I'd
Just how important is it? Well, yeah.
How they figure into the career of someone who is either
absolutely
self or other defined as independent.
Right. Well, I could start grope out an answer. I I didn't understand, and it's different now. It is more like what I naively thought it would be now, but I was making these really odd, strange little things, and I guess I still am. But I thought that if you managed to build on a little bit of success in the film festival world, that it was kind of like minor league baseball or something like that, that you could work your way up to the major leagues, which was, you know, big theater chains and Oscars. And
how did that work for you?
Well, let's see, zero Oscars. but I think I make, thanks to a accounting leisure domain, I think I make some money for some people taking losses on me. But I actually did enjoy a lot of film festival success. At least it grew with each of my first three features. But then I realized that it with my kind of movie, that no matter how high I rose in the film festival world, it was just on another planet as far as I was concerned from commercial films. It was like while I was building success up on the moon, other people were working on theirs on Earth or something like that. And so I went through a brief period of depression while I tried to create a new model of how the world worked. But of course, you can build on your success in the film festival world and cross over into art house distribution, and then maybe with an eye, either with luck in your material and the way you presented it, crossover, like Peter Greenaway did in a big way with The Cook, The Thief, The Wife and His Lover, where he made an art house hit that also became a big commercial hit, or you can calculate for it and make the leap, or you can wait till the zeitgeist changes a little bit, and like it has been like crazy in this century. And what defines independent cinema is changing very quickly now with distribution and stuff, and I'm not the expert to talk about that, but it did feel really good to get crowds coming out to my odd little things. And I remember Adam was actually very consoling after I had a movie. My third feature film, Careful, did very well at the New York Film Festival and then at the Toronto Festival, and then it opened commercially and averaged 2.1 people per screening and didn't even make it through its first week. I think it was pulled on a Tuesday. In Canada, films open on a Friday like they do here and closed on a Tuesday.
Not on 250 Tuesdays.
No, they couldn't afford to cut the prices on this. I don't know. It was a bit despairing, but Adam pointed out that film festival fever is one thing, and then where people will pay scalpers prices to see your movie in a theater that's packed, but then there are only so many people in each community that want to see a movie like that, and a lot of them see it already at film festivals, which is why distributors limit the number of screenings. And then, but also that fever subsides, and you couldn't pay those same people to go see your movie later. It's really interesting, but you do feel pretty independent at times like that. Like independent of a way, of a future.
Adam?
Yeah, it's fascinating to hear all this because I would say up until the mid 90s, I had no real sense of that crossover. I was making these films that were festival movies and I had a trajectory in mind. And I remember watching in awe at what was happening with Guy because we were really coming up at the same time. And I remember, you know, when you were celebrated at Telluride with, I think you had this, you were the youngest master, or you know, you got this award, and I remember just thinking, yeah, that's just so great, you know, that we have this kind of trajectory. And I was aiming for Cannes; that was really important for me. And,
yeah.
And my first feature, I'm now thinking, you know, blessedly was not The Second Coming. It was, you know, it played at Toronto, it played in some small European festivals. And it was coming out at the same time that John Pays' film Crime Wave came out, and I remember being like Guy, very, very impressed by this film. I don't know if you people have seen it, but it's such a tour de force in terms of like style, and realizing that I needed to be bolder with my style, and I made the second feature Family Viewing, and thinking it would get into Cannes, and it didn't, and this, then the third film got into the director's fortnight, but I really wanted to get into competition, and then I made The Adjuster, and it again got into fortnight, not competition. So there was this sort of, I was aiming for this prize, right? It was really clear to me that that's where I needed to go, and it's great to have this thing to focus on. I took Toronto for granted, to be honest, because, and to be clear, I'm not from Toronto, I'm from the west coast of Canada, actually further west than Guy. I'm from Victoria, British Columbia, so it's like the westernmost island city on Vancouver Island. So my upbringing was not in the mall of Toronto. As a matter of fact, it was, the westerners have a very different view of the country, and especially islanders, so just to be...
Yeah.
And also, John Waters is also another influence I should have mentioned as well, because his films were coming out at that time. Anyway, but going back to the festivals, I'll never forget this conversation. I had a film called Speaking Parts, third feature, at the New York Film Festival, and that's when I started meeting agents. And I met this agent from CAA, and he just, you know, really was impressed by the film and the performances and the talent. And I asked him, I remember so clearly, I said, so could I make a film like this in Los Angeles? And he went, well, no, but the whole idea is you want to make a different type of film. And I said, well, no, this is what I want to do. So if I can't make this type of film in Hollywood, why would I ever think of having an agent? And he looked at me as though I was just really stupid. And we kind of kept in touch, but I didn't have any contact again with Los Angeles or the industry until this breakout film I had called Exotica, which finally did get into competition in Cannes and was picked up by Miramax at the time. And they very shrewdly marketed this movie as a sex thriller. And not only that, but they saw it as being the first in a series of films about strippers, right? There was Striptease, there was, what was the other one that came out around that time? Showgirls, of course. So how could you forget? But this is right before that. And it was this breakthrough. And suddenly, I had to deal with the industry, right? And we just had our first child. I wasn't really making a living from films as such, and I realized I had to do that. And I spent this very confusing time in Los Angeles after Exotica, attached to this studio project at Warner Brothers. It was a really depressing year for me. I felt totally disconnected from what I thought I was going to be doing with my career, but also realizing this was this break. And then, thankfully, I was asked to be on the jury in Cannes, and so for 10 days I was away from that, and I was watching the type of films I really wanted to do, and so I was able to walk away from this studio film, which ended up never getting made, and make Sweet Hereafter. So, you know, that was sort of the...
Which was nominated for an Academy Award.
Which was nominated for an Academy Award. So it was
so
like,
by turning your back on
it was a very sweet time, I have to say. It was an incredible moment because a lot of the people were like saying, how can you leave this project? You're making the biggest mistake of your life. Well, I had optioned Russell Banks' book a year or two before, like right around the time of Exotica. And it's a good story because it was optioned by Columbia. And they were just sitting on it because they found they had a script, which I've never read. And Russell Banks, was very frustrated that they weren't making the film. And through Margaret Atwood, of all people, who I met at a party, and I expressed my admiration for this book and how difficult it was to get access to the agent or to Russell, she said, well, I'll call him. And she connected us. And he came up to Montreal. We met there. From Plattsburgh or wherever he is in the Adirondacks, and I promised him I can make this film through the Canadian system. I said that no matter how difficult the subject matter is, and I had this whole cell, and he gave me the rights, and with the promise that I would make it. So around the time I was about to go to Cannes, he said, well, why are you in Los Angeles with the studio project when you promised you would make, this movie? And he was right, and that's also one of the things that made me walk away from this, and it was very sweet to come back and make this film based on an American novel that probably would not be made in the U.S., but then have it reinfused into the system by a very savvy, again, lucky, it was New Line distributing it through Fine Line, and they were they needed to have that film this year, in that particular year. They needed to have the status, and that's really what you're at the mercy of with these movies, is if you have a distributor who's like really hungry to sell your project, because it's not commercial as such, but they need to create that dialogue, and they need to have that visibility. And so I was very lucky with that project as well.
Are you allowed to mention what the project you turned your back on was?
It was a film called Dead Sleep, and it was, if I explain it to you, it sounds better than it probably
that's always, would have been. You can never make a movie sound bad.
No, that's exactly right, so I won't bore you with it, but it was like really, well, I'll tell you also the interesting experience, if we have the time, about that was, from the moment I read it, I thought Susan Sarandon would be the perfect lead. This is like mid-90s, and the studio said, well, she can't open the picture for us. It has to be one of the six actresses that was on a pay or play deal. And I found out later on that all six had previously passed on the film. And I was like, I was there because I was the flavor of the week, you know, with Exotica, and they thought that maybe it might reignite their interest. So I had these futile sort of meetings with people who had already rejected the film.
Yeah.
And meanwhile,
this is all deja vu for them. Yeah,
yeah, and they're not interested. And Susan Sarandon was interested, and they wouldn't let me meet her because she wasn't considered viable. Then Dead Man Walking came out, and suddenly she was like super viable. And then she didn't want to meet because she was so pissed off that, you know, she wasn't allowed to meet with me before. And so it started this very tortured series of. And I was getting myself into this complete bog of like.
You're just waiting by the phone.
Everything is bad about LA,
yeah.
Right?
Mm-hmm.
And I think it was around that time where we crossed paths. Remember at Los Angeles?
We did, yeah. We hung out at some pool.
At some pool place.
And
I remember
just let the clock hands dig into our backs. It's our life ebbed away.
It's sort of inevitable that we sort of, you have to spend time in this place, but it's not really what we're designed to be doing. And yet, you know, it's a game that you play. And the festival world seems to be sort of independent of that. It seems to be this other trajectory, and maybe more than you, certainly, I've dirtied my hands, you know, in making these films that are projects for hire, you know, for a varying quality, you know, and whilst doing my own projects at the same time. I mean,
I've dirtied mine plenty, don't worry, but not with films. That's very ashamed if you need to hear if we've got 20 minutes to fill at the end of this panel.
Perhaps after everyone's left.
Okay, sure, yeah. Sure, all right. So a little late after you're gone, I'll speak, I will atone into this microphone.
Adam, since you just mentioned the notion of the commercial and having dirtied your hands with projects, which I assume you mean that you weren't, let's say, particularly invested in because they didn't mean that much to you. In terms of maybe your investment, I don't put words in your mouth, but part of what I think a lot of people think of as independence is this notion that you're going to make a project into something that is your own, that's distinctly, has your sensibility, that your concerns are reflected in it, this notion of a kind of an expression of self through films you're making. And I'm wondering if each of you could talk a bit about what that entails for you. So if you want to make this distinction between a project that you realize on your own terms, what that comes to be and mean for you, as opposed to them.
Yeah, I really like it when I have restrictions, frankly, and which is something that hamstrings my independence a little bit. It's just left to my own devices. For instance, I've taken on jobs for hire once, and always, strictly from hunger, out of desperation. Once I accepted a job I'd turned down many times for over a year, the shooting of a ballet version of Dracula. But I finally took it because I needed the director's fee. And I was really glad I did because I just knew I couldn't do it. I wasn't used to moving the camera, and I knew that ballet dancers needed to be followed. Right. You know, you want to keep them in the frame when they're moving around. And
I'm over here.
And I was so used to doing, yeah, all right, let me move the tripod over there. But I was so used to close-ups and montages and just telling the story through cutting. And I watched this ballet, and the idea of storyboarding it was beyond me. Luckily, I had to shoot it. And I was also scared. I had trouble staying awake watching the ballet because just sitting in the theater, I'm going, I gotta make this something I can watch, and I can't watch it. And but then I discovered something really interesting. I think my girlfriend made a decision for me. She said, that does it. You're not adapting this ballet. I want to go home now. And she just left and took me with her. and I was fine with that. But then I got a chance. I still needed the money. I woke up full of regret the next day, and I needed the money. And so the choreographer, who's really sweet, Mark Godden, grabbed me by the scruff of the neck during a rehearsal. They performed the ballet just for me, and I went on stage with a video camera. And he just held me by the scruff of the neck and with the promise that he wouldn't push me around, but would just pull me out of the way if I was standing where a ballerina's leg kick would take my head off or something. So I just got a chance to watch the ballet from up close, and I learned a lot. And I just tried to follow it with my camera, and I learned how to move a camera and get... And a lot of times I found myself shooting close-ups of ballerinas, and I thought, wait a minute, I better back up and get their whole body in or they'll be insulted. And I learned from them later that they liked having close-ups. Yeah. And that the ideal performance of a ballet for many of these dancers would involve the stage and people sitting out in the theater, and then a jumbotron featuring close-ups over top of the proscenium or something like that. And it was really nice to learn. And I also felt the chaos. Things that looked very symmetrical from out in the house felt very chaotic when you were there, when ballerinas and when all the dancers were spinning around and you get sprayed with sweat and you could hear a tutu ripping or something, or an Achilles tendon snapping or something, I don't know, just around you. And all of a sudden I realized my sloppy, uncontrolled filmmaking style might be okay for this. So in other words, I was doing a job for hire and I didn't feel very independent, but I ended up imposing a style on it that I'm glad I did it.
Yeah.
I'm really glad I did it.
I want to point out two things. That it's few filmmakers who would see filming a ballet about Dracula as a concession to some kind of commercialism. But the second thing is that just because you haven't said it, that I believe that work then went on to win an Emmy.
It did win some sort of Emmy. Yeah, I think like with an Emmy with an asterisk beside it or something. Some sort of special Emmy or something.
for most sweat and broken tendons.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. I don't know what the category was, but... It worked out okay, and I learned a lot from it. And then I've since tried to take commissions whenever possible, especially really challenging ones, but not the ones that would clearly crush me. And so I've said no to a few things that just weren't going to work, or you get a bad vibe about the whole thing. But so I've been independent, but a lot of times, and when I've worked with Neve Fitchman, whom you know very well, and I can't remember if he's ever produced anything.
The Saraband, the Yo-Yo.
Right, right, thing. Yeah. He's a very hands-on producer. He likes to get in there, and you want to kill him half the time. You know, you find yourself putting your thumbs up to his eyeballs when he's napping and trying to press them in. But he gets more out of you. So you don't feel like you have complete freedom, but he makes sure that you hammer it out and you argue until you both grudgingly and then finally just happily agree, and then pretty soon you're taking credit for all the suggestions he was imposing on you. So independence doesn't just mean working in a vacuum and doing whatever you want. And it's super collaborative. I've never really asked Adam how dictatorial or not he is with his collaborators, but you just have to be collaborative. Yeah, maybe I'll, I wonder how dictatorial Adam is.
I mean, the projects that you write, direct, produce are personal projects. And I think if you look at the stuff I've done, those ones I could all say are very connected to experiences that I've had or feelings that I've had. And that's why I've done them independently, because I wanted to protect that. I do read a lot of scripts that are sent to me, and sometimes they're really intriguing. And sometimes the films are good. I think sometimes they're maybe not so good, but I can always explain to myself why I chose those projects. I mean, there's something about that subject matter that I found compelling. I think, and you have to be passionate about it. You can't, because you have to convince a lot of people. You have to get a cast on board. You have to have these conversations with people, and you have to be passionate. If you're not, they're not going to be activated. So, and you can't fake that. So there has to be something about these projects that you find really irresistible at some level. The jury's out. Some people like it, some people hate it, some people think it's useless, but let's say a film like Devil's Not. Well, for me to suddenly be plunged into the West Memphis world of the West Memphis Three, looking at the fact that, you know, there had been so many documentaries, the case had been so mediated, but each of those documentaries had a point of view as to who might have done this and who should have been the target of, you know, the hunt. And I just thought it was so interesting to have a feature which had no theory, that basically just laid it all out, said that this was everything that was going on and came to no conclusion at all. Mm-hmm. I just found that really intriguing. Yeah. And I immersed myself into that, and it became a part of my life for a very long time. The unfortunate thing about it is that you don't have control over production, so the things that you're promised, like the schedules that you're promised or the budgets that you're promised, they kind of wither away for whatever reason. There's always an excuse. And yeah. It's like, and you feel a bit like a, you don't have control over that. When I'm producing, I have complete control. I know exactly what the budget is. I know that's not going to change. I know that that's, you know, there are going to be all sorts of things that come up during a shoot, you know, emergencies, weather problems, you know, illnesses, and you accommodate that because part of what you understand to be what filmmaking involves. But what I have found very exhausting is when, you know, you are invited to deal with material and you're told what the parameters are, what the playpen is, this is the size, you get to, you know, build this castle, and then once you're in it, you realize either through deception or incompetence that box is getting smaller and smaller and smaller, and you can't really do anything at that point. Mm-hmm. I remember calling my agent when I saw the budget kind of like withering and going from an 8-week shoot down to 5, right. You know, I mean, I'm saying, well, what can I do? And he said, you quit. I mean, you just quit. You walk away. But at that point, you've got all the cast on board. You've got everyone excited about it. They're all passionate. And it just feels wrong. So that's, you know, on the other hand, you get these experiences like Chloe, which, you know, it's funny. I'd seen the original French film many years ago, and I loved it, actually, and Fontaine's film. Would never have occurred to me to make a remake at all. And then I got asked, you know, by Ivan Reitman to do a remake of this with a writer I really, like Erin Cressida Wilson wrote Secretary, and I've been in touch with her since, you know, her theater plays in New York, and she wrote this really interesting script. And I always wanted to work with Julianne Moore and you know, Amanda Seyfried. I'd just done a play in New York with Liam Neeson, and he said, let's do something else. He said, well, let's do this. And so I got him attached. And so it was kind of fun, you know. And I actually, there were a lot of things happening in my life at that time, which made the film strangely personal. Like, there was a lot of stuff in it about marriage, and there were a lot of conversations, and it resonated. And it ended up being, you know, by far, like, the most successful film I've ever done commercially. But in a way, you can attribute that to Ivan Reitman. Ivan and Jason, actually. It was like a father-son tag team, and I was sort of sandwiched in between, which was, you know, frustrating because they both had a lot of input, but on the other hand, they allowed me, you know, they wanted me to make the film to look like Exotica. That was interesting. When I was hired, it was like they both liked the look of, the feel of Exotica. And I told them, well, you know, that's so much to do with the structure of Exotica. And they said, no, but the look of it, you know, the way, the sexiness of it. And I went, okay, well, whatever. I mean, sure. I'll and so when I look at the film now, I mean, I feel like I did a good job with it. You know, I feel like I did what I was hired to do, and part of that was because it was personal. There were things in it that I could have conversations about and which I could explore. Devil's Knot as well. This idea of a narrative that, like, a tragedy that, you know, besets a town, and there's absolutely nothing to make of it at all. There's like, you know, what do you just sort of, you create all of this sense of expectation and outrage in the viewer, but there's nothing that resolves. And I thought that was an interesting, bold experiment. Whether or not, you know, you think it's good or not, I know why I did it. I certainly know why I did the film that we premiered here, Remember, in terms of the themes in it. But if you're not originating the idea of making the film, if you're not seeing this as a film that should be made, then it's not, for me, a personal film. The most outrageous thing that I admire so much with Guy's work is, like, just the wherewithal to kind of think that this is something that demands to be made, and you feel that urgency with Guy's work. You know, you get excited. Like, each of these films, when they came out in the 80s, you know, Tales from Gimli Hospital and Archangel,
careful. There was this excitement that there was this new Guy Maddin project. and you were, I remember going to those screenings and you just get caught up in this like incredible vision of what cinema can be. And I remember when we were all asked to do these shorts for the 25th anniversary of the Toronto Film Festival. And I put my project was up there and it was kind of okay. And then Map of the World came out and I was like going, oh my God, that is just brilliant. It's like, it's incredible to see an artist using a cinema at that level to exercise a personal, obsession. And that's what I think that the work that you're doing and
I was very lucky then. I had been unemployed for 4 years and I had all this time to make a 4 minute movie.
And you were dealing.
So the other filmmakers in that invitation, in that anthology, they were busy making movies and stuff like that. Well, so I had a lot of extra time.
Whatever it was, just like.
But thank you.
And then watching like My Winnipeg, I love hockey. I was raised with hockey like most Canadian kids are. And, I don't think there's been a better cinematic depiction of what the mythology of hockey is than those moments in your film.
No,
like, it just feels like, oh, that gets it, And again, it's very personal, you have a family connection to hockey, and it's like profound and deep and like so rich. So you're able to vein into that, and, we all have these experiences that sometimes we can use to tell stories with.
Yeah, I don't even know. After making my first few features, I remember making the last cut on Careful and going, I don't know what to do anymore. Like, I really felt satisfied that I'd finished, but simultaneously lost for some reason. I spent the rest of the 90s kind of just drifting. And then I just, I'd been reading, of all things, around the turn of the century, some Euripides. I felt, well, at least I should read, and I should read these really dry, uninviting Greek tragedies. Who knows? They've been in print for 2,500 years. Maybe there's something in them. And I suddenly found myself in them. I found, or people I knew. It suddenly occurred to me that I found an identification point in these really ancient things. The way you can find yourself in the Bible, or in a fairy tale, or a bedtime story, the Brothers Grimm. And it suddenly occurred to me that I could just write disguised autobiographical material, make it very personal, but steal the structure of Euripides, figuring, well, this stuff's pretty proven, people seem to like it, but I could gussy it up with a hockey story or something. And then I finally just went all the way and made my protagonist Guy Maddin. I just named him a Guy Maddin. It was me, and that way I could. That motivated me to be even more personal, to be more masochistically personal. I confessed. All of a sudden, these characters who are always just types in my movie, but became slightly richer types, more cowardly, more sexually repulsive, and more just conniving, and all of a sudden I was just hauling in long forgotten episodes, and instead of feeling shame, I was feeling excitement because I had a new scene in a movie all of a sudden, and so I went too far with it, because you really shouldn't, an artist shouldn't have to include him or herself all the time by name.
Ask Cole Oster,
novels. Of course,
novels.
No, it happens.
It does happen,
and there is a place for it, and then it's, of course, the lyric essay now always involves the first person singular, and it's a whole new art form almost. And then there's, when My Winnipeg came out, I decided to call it a docufantasia because I thought it was a all new hybrid. But of course, Chris Marker had been making mischievous things, and there's been all sorts of documentaries that mix fiction and fact all the time, and it's a really exciting genre. But I wasn't even aware of it yet, but it was a way in to make things even more personal, but it also marginalized me a bit more. But my vocabulary has taken care of marginalizing me, and then my own personality. But I'm also, you've worked on a larger number of projects for hire or with American producers or whatever, and I think I'm here to stay now. or unless the zeitgeist just changes and suddenly someone decides that a guy closing in on 60 needs to get his first Hollywood film now or something like that. We'll see.
But it's also kind of great. We're both at this point where you kind of know what you are and what you're not, definitely what you're not. And you've seen, I mean, I've seen, like, you know, my colleagues, like independent filmmakers, some of them, like, you know, soar to this extraordinary place where they've crossed over completely, and then others disappear, you know, and they continue doing good work, but somehow the culture has shifted in a way, and you know, I feel very fortunate that, you know, we're still making these films.
Yeah,
and
it's amazing.
And that we're able to get them seen, and that there's a dialogue around them. And look, even just looking at the selection of movies here, it's there's so many films being made, and I think we had this great gestation period in the 80s when it wasn't like everyone wanting to make films, like it wasn't, and it was difficult to actually make work that was presentable because it cost money because of the film stock, and we were both able to use that to our advantage and use the roughness of the films to help tell the story. But there's such a high expectation now of technical proficiency, and
way more movies are made.
And way more movies are
being
made.
Just statistically true. Yeah.
But both of you, I mean, Adam, maybe a little bit more so in your case, but you've worked in media or art forms other than film. Mm-hmm. So for you, opera started in theater. Both of you have done installations. What does it mean? I mean, how important is that for you to not see yourself solely defined through the medium of film?
In my case, it's just I thought maybe even emulating Adam, I'd noticed that he'd worked in a lot of things, and I thought maybe I should at least start diversifying a little bit, just in case I suddenly, because feature films, even in the digital age, are still expensive to make. What if I suddenly can't make them anymore? Maybe I better stick my foot in the museum or art gallery world. So I hung around until a door opened a little bit and stuck my foot in and managed to get some installations. They were always film related though, and I always, almost always felt I wasn't really making installations. I shot a bunch of my most recent movie, The Forbidden Room, which is playing here tomorrow night, was shot in public in the foyer of the Centre Pompidou in Paris and in this public space, the Phi Center in Montreal. Anyone could come in and watch, but they were just film shoots. Really, I called them installations, but they were just public film shoots. And I've had screenings and loops installed places, but those are just films. Just right. So I felt like a bit of a cheater. I have made a few other installations. I recreated my childhood bedroom and did things in there I never really got to do in real life. That was an installation, I think. Wasn't a film. I held. That sounded horrible. But I inherited my brother's bedroom when I was very little, and I did things with it that neither my brother or I ever got to do. So I don't know. That sounds a little better. We made some sort of fraternal connection in there. It was kind of a nice. That was a real installation, I think. But other than that, and I've never directed opera. I almost did. I don't know what happened. Under Richard Bradshaw, he and I had a handshake agreement to do Leos Janacek's Houses of the Dead. And it sort of just, it would have been wonderful. Although it's an all-male cast, and my big dream was to be slapped across the face by an angry opera diva.
And, it's not fun when it happens.
But I went to see your Salome, which is incredible. Of course, you incorporated tons of video projections in it, just so beautifully, and so it was really awesome. But I couldn't wrap my head around what I would myself would do. I'm still a filmmaker,
right.
And I'm not even sure I'm entirely that. You know, I'm
kind
of an odd
are.
One.
You,
well,
you
I am, but I'm
decidedly are. But I mean, yeah. But on the other hand, I started in theater, like as Charlie knows.
I didn't realize that.
And when I was in my early 20s, like that's what I wanted to do was to write plays, and I was doing it at U of T before I was making films. Then I realized that all the plays I was writing were really influenced by these writers that I just adored, like, you know, Beckett and Pinter and Mamet later on.
Yeah.
And as a matter of fact, I just saw this revival of Old Times in on Broadway, and I just realized, oh my God, that play was so influential. But I always was under their thrall. And when I started making films, you pointed to something very interesting, is this kind of ignorance. Like, you think you're doing something that no one else has done, and that gets very exciting, but it's just because you're not aware of the tradition. But that allows you to forge ahead in a way, and I never got to do that with plays, except then I was asked by Richard Bradshaw, like, back into this huge, talk about, you know, sandbox, play box.
Well, that's big. Richard Bradshaw is the maestro of the Canadian Opera Company, the biggest, by far the biggest opera company in the country.
So that just started, you know, like these this relationship and doing operas and going back to theater. And it's been really enriching. And if the installations for me are, you know, a lot of them are about the material nature of film. Like this one I did a play version of Samuel Beckett's Crap's Last Tape. And I was very aware as I was filming it on 35 millimeter film that this was an analog recording of a play about analog recording, right? It's Samuel Beckett is a 39-year-old guy listening to these audio these recordings of his reflections on his life that he does every year on his birthday, and has been doing it, you know, until the age of 69, which is when the play takes place. And I was aware of the fact that I now making this, recording this with John Hurt, this great performance, I wanted to actually do something about the endurance of the actual recording material. So the last shot in the film is 20 minutes long on 35 millimeter film, which means it's 2,000 feet of film. And we had to get the special magazine, which was huge, and it was just so
cumbersome. Because it's normally only 1,000, right?
Yes, yeah. So it's 2,000 feet. And once I shot it, I thought, you know, and I looked at the film, it's going, it's such an exciting shot, but how do you remind people of the extraordinary material aspect of this? And so that led to this installation which I did in London, which is now actually remounted in Birmingham as we speak, called Steen Beckett, where we took the 2,000 feet of this performance, the last shot, and put it through a Steen Beck, which is like the old editing machine, and then all 2,000 feet were set up on rollers. Like it didn't go onto a reel, but rather it was suspended in this cloud above you. So as you entered the room or the gallery, you hear this like this weird sound, and it's all the sound of all of these little
pulleys,
pulleys and stuff like that, holding up 2,000 feet of film as it's being powered by the engine in the editing machine itself. So it's just improbable, and it's just fantastic to kind of go into it. And then over the course of the month, this image begins to deteriorate because, of course, 2,000 feet of exposed film picks up dust, it gets scratched. And by the end of the installation period, like of a month, you're not seeing anything on the screen of the editing machine.
So it's projected as well.
So it's projected at the same time.
Yeah.
So it's a sculptural piece. Actually, if you want to see it, if you go on YouTube and look up Steen Beckett, like S-T-E-E-N, Beckett, you'll see it.
That's
beautiful.
See
the installation of it.
That.
So those types of things are just exciting.
So it takes a month for the image to be just, the emulsion just to be worn off.
Worn out, yeah, completely. And meanwhile, there's in a room beside it, there's a digital copy of the same image, and it doesn't change at all, of course. So it's a reflection
on
all these things. So to me, like, the gallery pieces or the installations are very much reflections on the same ideas that I'm touching on in the films. But I have found now with the digital vocabulary, we're not that aware of the textures that I was interested in exploring in the 80s are irrelevant now. Between film and video, there was a strong distinction between the two mediums, and you could play off of that, but that has become, again, the two
the
have conflated.
Been closed.
Conflated into one. And it's one of the things I love, one of the many things I love about your films too, is that the material aspect of the film is so much a part of the experience, you know, and you're aware of the fact that that this can all break apart and that it's very corporeal in a way.
Yeah, I don't know if anyone will even know what that means very soon. You know.
Yeah. Well, like, it's true. Like, I remember when Quentin Tarantino came out with Grindhouse, you know, like the two, you know, and he was trying to replicate the idea of splicing and, you know, things breaking up, but he was doing it digitally.
Yeah.
And it just sort of, I know what it means, but I don't think a lot of people would get it, you know, from a younger generation.
Guy, can you talk a little bit, since Adam has opened the door on this, about...
Or Adam's talking too much. Yeah.
This idea of how film and the memory of film plays into your work. This notion of retrieval of something that's lost, because that's always been present. I mean, when people talk about your films, they often talk about, you know, how there's this kind of deliberate, almost anachronistic quality to what you do and how that figures in.
I've learned my style was quickly determined by default. I knew I wanted to make a movie. when I made my first movie, but I didn't know what it would look like. I wasn't even thinking in visual terms at all. I knew it probably shouldn't have too much talking in it because the actors who agreed to be in it had lousy voices. And so I knew, make it sort of silent, but I wasn't particularly a silent movie buff. And then I read about the basic three light system, the key light, then the fill light to soften the nose shadow a little bit, and then a backlight just to inhalo the head and make it pop out from the background. But when I plugged all these in on the very first day of shooting, I just got three nose shadows on my actor. And so I unplugged the backlight, and that somehow got down to two nose shadows. I unplugged the fill light, and I got down to one, but it sort of left him with an Adolf Hitler mustache, of the black Adolf Hitler mustache. So I moved the light until it just looked like a nose shadow, and I just shot with one light. And it had the advantage of isolating the face in a little nimbus of light, slightly overexposed. And the backgrounds quickly graded off to nothing. And since I didn't really have sets anyway, that served me well. And I shot in black and white. So the films kind of looked like high contrast black and white prints of old movies, because in those days, no longer, films are restored beautifully by Criterion and other companies. But in those days, you'd watch old movies on 16 millimeter prints. And with each generation, if you remember from photocopy days, if you did a photocopy of a photocopy of a photocopy, with each generation, it got more high contrast. So you'd just have a very white face and very black backgrounds. And often the detail that was put there at great cost and effort was gone forever. And my movies kind of looked like that, and all of a sudden they had a style. And because I suddenly found myself good at making things that reminded people of silent movies, I started watching them and understanding them from the inside a bit, from seeing them as versions of bedtime stories, because silent movies are one big step towards a fairy tale away from naturalism. And so I got enthused about silent film and their the mannerisms, their vocabularies, by accidentally being a little bit like them. And then in talking about the movies, I remember vowing never to say the same thing twice in an interview, because my favorite filmmaker at the time was David Lynch, and I was really knocked out by his interviews. And then I read them all, and I found, but he repeated himself. And so I decided to never to repeat myself if I ever became, you know, someone interviewed. So I quickly ran out of the truth. And so I started lying like crazy about myself. And I quickly ran out of lies even, you know, and then I started going back and creating lie-truth hybrids and trying to shuffle them around and remembering from my old, math undergrad days, how many permutations and combinations you could get. And then years later, after the dust settled on all this lying I'd been doing, I realized that there's something about lying that's the same as telling the truth anyway, that it's the lies you choose to tell about yourself. You don't just lie. You think you're just lying for fun or something like that, but there's a kind of a weird truth that settles out of it, because you're curating your lies apparently to conceal something. But there's some, I don't know, by the time you finish lying, you basically just revealed yourself anyway because of the nature of the way you lie. So this was all leading to to answer your question. It really is. But I can't remember what your question is. What?
The retrieval of the past.
Right. So I talked a lot, just bullshitting wildly, about why, you know, in those early days when my films looked like old films, I talked a lot about, well, maybe it was because when I was, you know, brought home from the hospital, I was put facing in the wrong direction on the floor or something, looking into the past. I did notice that, I was the youngest by far. I had three older siblings, and I didn't do much reading as a kid. All I had was photo albums to look at, and everyone seemed happier and younger in those photos in those days before I existed. And now they seemed worn out and miserable. And I seemed to have created a photo emulsion fairy tale version of all the people I loved most that involved not just my absence, but photo emulsions and black and white and old-timey things. And so I said that, but I'm not even sure, maybe that's too glib, but there is something emotionally backward about the way I've, you know, we're all messed up when in relation to our relatives and the people we love most anyway, but I there is something backward looking always in the way I did things, and there was something that just seemed I think I was just thrilled to get, frankly, it's quite simple, I think I was just thrilled to get any atmosphere in the movie I shot, my very first movie, when I hadn't even given it a thought. And so I just went with that. But then I started buttressing that style choice, which was thrust on me by my own ineptitude, with all sorts of theoretical, emotional reinforcements, reasons. And I don't know, I developed a kind of a trapeze on my own, a really highfalutin one about how my heart was just a blob of emulsive chemicals or something like that. I don't know, and I can't even remember my own lies anymore. But it came out of me riffing on why I was doing things when the real reason was I was just scared to do anything else, probably. So, and now years later, I think with The Forbidden Room, the movie that's playing, it's all shot digitally, but it's one last huge unburdening of everything I've ever cared about visually and texturally about film and its emulsions and how they fade and how they decay and how time passes and how we're all swept up in the time's great flow and how life is as much about loss as anything else and all those themes that I'm on the verge of growing weary about discussing and thinking about. But I'm now, luckily I've now started with some new collaborators on I made this installation at TIFF called Bring Me the, by the way, I'm really proud of The Forbidden Room. I'm really pleased with it. But I'm looking forward to leaving those emulsions behind now and ersatz emulsions, digital versions of them. And I made this installation with my collaborators, Evan Johnson and Galen Johnson, called Bring Me the Head of Tim Horton. It references a famous dead hockey player in Canada. And it's a cine essay, and all of a sudden, it was supposed to be a feature, but it's only 30 minutes long. It's a making of Canadian director Paul Gross's movie Hyena Road. But I was hoping, and it was paid for by Paul Gross and Neve Fitchman, and I was hoping to trick them into paying for a feature film just by making a making of, but then we stuck our cameras right next to their cameras, just hoping to steal without paying for it, all their actors and their costumes and their props and their locations and everything, and then just Shanghai the whole thing and recut it into a plot that we had in mind. But they stopped short of giving us enough money to make it into a feature, even though what we did shoot was for virtually nothing. But I got really excited about these non-fictional documentary, which is what it is, and its potential. And it's purely digital, it's set in contemporary times, and there's just so many fun things you can do narratively now that I think I'm moving on. It did help that, and I'm almost finished this very vague answer, that The Forbidden Room was based on years of researching. It's made up of the plot fragments of lost movies, and I researched so many lost movies, hundreds of lost movies, and Evan and Bob Kotick and I rewrote wrote our own adaptations of their long forgotten scripts and plot lines, and we wrote so many scripts that I was like going to a script writing boot camp for about 4 or 5 years. And so now I feel like, I feel like I could write these new weird hybrid things that seems to be my future in film anyway.
Okay, so just before we're going to turn this over to the audience, I just want Adam in a way to parallel what Guy just did, which is to
great.
Since I don't even know what I just did.
Don't worry. I will specify what I mean by that.
Sorry. I'm really sorry.
I'd actually like you to stand on your head while you're doing an acrobatic routine. What I'd like you to do is just tell us a bit about the genesis of Remember and how you see it relating to sort of where you are with your career.
Well, I've had this really intense few years. I've done 3 features like back to back, and the last feature, which is something that I've been working on for a long time, and which I'm very proud of, but which got a very hostile response. A film called The Captive, and I've in my own scripts worked with non-linear structures, and I thought I finally had this incredible basis for a non-linear structure, which is that a girl is abducted by a pedophile at the age of 8, and then 10 years later, she's still with this monster, but she's now an adult, and so he has no interest in her, but he's now, they've become kind of a weird couple in his mind, and I thought, oh, that's interesting that we have this weird couple, this marriage that shouldn't be. But then meanwhile, outside, there was the father and the mother, and their marriage deteriorates over the disappearance of the girl because the woman blames the husband for having left her. But still they're in contact, they still love each other, but they can't live together, and that's a marriage that also, that is not to be. And then there was this marriage between the two detectives who meet while looking for her, police detectives working with Special Investigative Unit, and they form a relationship over the case of this girl. And I thought, the nonlinear structure could work so well because every year on the birthday, the mother goes to visit one of these detectives to see what the status of the case was, and I was so excited by this. And it's been really, it was kind of a traumatic kind of launch. I was talking about it with Guy, and I don't mean to lick my wounds too much publicly, but it was like, we showed it at the Cannes Film Festival, and it was like really a violent response against the movie. It's since gone on to have this real strong, there's a following, it's on iTunes and Amazon Prime and whatever, you can watch it. But when I read the script of Remember, I thought there was something so amazing about how linear it was. And I was so confused about the response to this last film that here was suddenly the story that dealt with all of these ideas of loss and memory and trauma, but it was told in this very simple story that moved from A to B to C, and it was all in real time, and just following one character. And that was immediately appealing. And I knew that if I could get Christopher Plummer, who I'd worked with on Ararat, and it could be this commanding performance, and it would deal with a lot of the issues that fascinated me, but in a way I could probably have never have written myself. And, I think that I'm now trying to figure out, of these 3 projects, between Devil's Knot, The Captive, and now Remember, what it is I want to do next and how I want to proceed, because I feel that, you get to a point, and I don't know if you felt this, where people identify, you have a relationship with critics who have been following you for a long time, and quite frankly, they're a bit tired of your style. But then you realize that when you put a film like Captive out into the world with Ryan Reynolds and Rosario Dawson, that there are a whole generation of people who've never seen one of your films before. And they're going to get really charged because they're seeing something that they haven't encountered, and they're trying to make their way through it, and they get really excited, and yet you're not making the film for those people because you don't know that audience specifically. You're just telling the type of story you've always wanted to tell. And you have to kind of deal with the agendas of people who have been following you or people who, have their own theories about what is. I'll never forget. There was a very well-known critic saw an early film of mine called Calendar at the Berlin Film Festival. And coming out of the screening, she approached me and she said, "That is the best film you will ever make." and I went like crazy proclamation.
Strange
and then
compliment.
What happened? And I'm almost going to give away who she is because when Exotica came out a year later, She was initially going to do the review for The Village Voice, and she eviscerated the movie. She just basically tore it apart. And thankfully, Jay Hoberman, you know, saw the film and called it like the best film of the winter. You know, so you kind of went, oh, well, go figure. Like, I mean, like I guess when you say to someone, a filmmaker, that's the best you'll ever get, then you have to follow it up with, you know,
with a body blow.
With a body blow, yeah. Right? And I'll tell you something else, which I've never gone public with, but I'll tell you, like where I've become really disillusioned with this all was with Chloe. We had an advanced screening, and you know, I'll just say it. We had an advanced screening for the LA Times. Like, it was before the premiere at the Toronto Film Festival, and Studio Canal, who had the film, gave it to this critic, and said, you know, that she would have the exclusive to write the review of the film. And if she liked it, they would use her quote. If she didn't, she would just park it until the film was released. Well, kind of an odd arrangement, but okay. She gave this amazing review. And we started quoting it, and it was like a great, great review. When the film was then released, and it started getting mixed reviews, she actually re-reviewed it negatively. You know, and I just thought that said to me so much about the state of contemporary criticism, you know, where there is this, because I think so many critics are afraid of their jobs and kind of like falling out of favor with like a herd mentality, that there's this viciousness which I've never really felt before, and there's this rush to kind of make judgment, and it's a different temperament. And what's really refreshing and exciting is that it doesn't really matter anymore what critics say. You know, like it really is just about whether or not the film is going to get to public, and there's going to be discussion. And the issue is whether or not that barrage of bad reviews is going to block that conversation from happening.
Yeah.
And that is what's terrifying. I mean, I think we're both in a place where what we make is going to find its way somehow. But for a younger generation, I think it must be very disheartening to be the subject of that, you know, like, or to be victimized that way. And when we were starting our films, there were these critics that were very important. Like, they were, like, they, what they said and what they proclaimed was, and I think I was saying this to you yesterday, I was very lucky that one of the most important critics kind of dismissed my first feature in Canada. Yeah. You know, basically said it was like, it was below the radar, was his word. And I realized from that point I needed to have an incredibly thick skin. I looked back at some of the reviews I was doing at U of T about theater, like on campus, and I was like incredibly vicious. And because it's entertaining, like bad reviews are like, it's really, you know, it's kind of fun to demolish something. So I in some ways I'm maybe paying the price for some of this like stuff where
it's just a little karma.
It's just really hilarious. Like, I remember writing this review of there's a Canadian filmmaker, Don Shabib, who's kind of like one of the icons of Canadian film. And I wrote a review of a movie he made called Grey Owl or something like that. And I was just literally making fun of him. And I was going like, who did I think I was? I was like 20 years old.
Yeah.
You know? I thought
he probably just stayed in bed an extra week because of that review.
You know, it's sort of a, anyway.
Yeah.
So I don't even remember what the question was. But I'll tie it in by saying that, yes, your fantasy about emulsion is something that I share.
That wasn't the question at all, but nonetheless. So we will now open it up to the floor. Yes, I see there's a question already. I don't know if there's going to be a mic that's run. It appears there is, so if you could just hold on. And
hi.
I don't think so.
We're not hearing any difference.
Sure. Okay.
I'd love your turn to the personal documentation. I'm going to steal it.
It's all yours.
but I want to talk about, like, one of my favorite, probably my favorite film of yours is which is one of the
great, yeah,
most unusual personal docs I've ever seen in history. And I'd love to hear the origins of that and, you know, how it came about.
Okay. I remember once telling myself, well, at various times in my career, I told myself that who knows where I'll end up if I'm lucky enough to keep working in film, because I sort of entered it through the back door, through that way I told you about a long time ago in Winnipeg, and then I suddenly found myself magically transported from a Winnipeg basement film world in the real world. And but I had no idea what kind of films I'd be making in the future, but I knew for sure one thing: I would never make a documentary, because I'd heard that documentaries had a much higher shooting ratio. You know, a shooting ratio is how much you shoot compared to how much ends up on the finished product. That, you know, maybe a fiction film has a 10-to-1 or whatever shooting ratio, depending on your budget. But documentaries, just they need at least 100-to-1, and that the actual documentary, there's a saying that the documentaries are created in the editing room. Just sounded like so much work, and it also involved more respect and research than I was ever willing to respect for anything, and research hours that I just thought, oh, that's not for me. And it just reminded me too much of the university assignments I never completed on time or something like that. So, in 2004, so whenever I was, you know, I was 49 years old or whatever, I found myself yet again broke. And I'd made a little docu-fantasia with Isabella Rossellini the year before called My Dad is 100 Years Old, where she just fantasizes about her father. And I made it for 17 minutes, her father, Roberto Rossellini, on the occasion of his centennial. That got my foot in the door at the Documentary Channel, this really wondrous, short-lived network in Canada. And I heard a rumor that Michael Burns, the director and president of the Documentary Channel, was interested in commissioning another documentary like that from me. And I thought, oh great, maybe I'll get to make this something and I'll get some money. And then I just kept hearing this rumor, but he never contacted me. So finally I just phoned him and said, I heard the rumor that you're interested in my making a documentary for your TV network. Is it true? And he said, yeah, sure, you know. And I said, well, what would you like me to make? And he said, what would you like to make? And I said, I don't know. You know, I said, well, can you assign me something? Because I liked the assignment of doing Dracula, and I felt that I learned so much. And I thought, well, maybe I'll just learn something. So he said, well, I like trains. Can you make a documentary on trains? And I went, I don't know. Sounds like a lot of research. And he said, well, how about your hometown then? And I'd always wanted to mythologize my hometown in movies. I felt that Winnipeg was a city like any other. It had its things about it, and that I'd had a sense of other cities without ever visiting them. I knew sort of what Cleveland would be like before I got there, because it gets mentioned. There's a mythology about it, about Kansas City. I knew I could never make Winnipeg seem like one of the great world capitals, like Paris or Rome or New York, but I could at least make it into a kind of a Cleveland with film, and you know, so give it a myth size, Cleveland-sized myth size, you know, and so I took the project, and then this is coming from the director of the president of the Documentary Channel. He said, and don't okay, so you're going to do Winnipeg, and don't just show us the frozen hellhole. We all know what it is, you know. So do something with it. I don't know, and so. I just started to, a couple days later, I found myself in Paris showing my movie, The Saddest Music in the World, which is set in Winnipeg, and I'd already started to try to mythologize Winnipeg as a frozen but romantically bleak place. And someone during the Q&A period, just like you, just asked me, so what's with Winnipeg? And I started to give an answer, and it's plausible because my answers are very long. I just started making up stuff about Winnipeg for this Paris audience. And it was just, you know, I was just saying, well, the Winnipeg has the highest sleepwalking rate in the world. I don't know, it's just making up crap. That you're not allowed, it's a very nostalgic city, you're allowed by law to keep the keys to your old house and use them whenever you want to, no matter who's living there now. I don't know, I was just making up crap, and they were all buying it for some reason. And so, while it was all still fresh in my mind, I gave about a 20-minute answer in which I just basically wrote the script for my Winnipeg. So I went back to my hotel room and wrote it all down in an email and sent it to Michael Burns, the director of the Documentary Channel, and said, this is what I'd like to shoot. And he said, go ahead. So that was That was it. It was just a bunch of myths, you know, but some of them are true, but thank you, yeah. No, but it felt very good. It came out, I found that the only good ideas I've ever had, if there are any, the ones that have served me well the most have been things that have just come out of somewhere. But like I said before, I've learned that lies reveal as much as they conceal, or probably reveal more than, they probably don't conceal anything. So there was all a lot of wishful thinking that I was just lying about. And that's how. Yeah, exactly, yeah. Oh, really?
They get such a reaction.
Yeah, Merry Christmas. Yeah. Yes. Yeah, just heads sticking out of her. Yeah, it's kind of grim, but it's, yeah, it's a.
People so much and they want to know a story.
Yeah. They can. They can learn the story by buying the DVD or something. I don't know. Thanks. And you had a question back there.
Back there.
Well, I mean, I think it's pretty clear that, you know, you used to need to raise money for a script based on the quality of a screenplay. I mean, that was your blueprint. So, and you would work on a screenplay and hope that you could prove to someone that that story was worth telling. And now, I mean, it seems you could just rush out and start shooting. And having been on, you know, some juries and, you know, watching a lot of, you know, the current crop of independent films, I'm always impressed that for the first 10 minutes, your jaw drops. You go, wow, this looks amazing. But then very often you realize this person knows nothing about storytelling, or they haven't really done that apprenticeship. They haven't done what Guy said about going back to like Greek classics and theater. Like, you really need to know the history of storytelling, I think, you know, to be able to give yourself that pulpit. Right, because it's an amazing thing to be, you know, commanding, you know, an audience's attention for an hour and a half. So, how do you tell stories, and what's the nature of what it is you're trying to convey? That requires an intense period of study. I don't think you just start doing it. And, you know, with us, I suppose that you needed to sort of prove that you had something to say so that you could raise the monies you would need in order to start telling those stories. But it seems that people somehow have access to funding, or they're just able to do it out of their own pocket and, you know, make something quite effortlessly, which is a feature film. But whether or not it actually warrants that is another issue. So I guess, but on the other hand, these are issues that have been, you know, like, novelists have had, anyone could write a novel, anyone could, you know, create a piece of music. For a long period of time, not everyone can make a film, but now everyone can. So maybe these are just issues that the other arts, you know, have dealt with forever, you know, but for a certain amount of time, the means of production was quite limited.
Yeah, it became an exclusive club.
A very exclusive club.
But
not
like
anymore.
We were the, you know, the man or anything, but you had to go through at least to raise a certain amount of
money. And then look at how long, you know, like for distribution, you then, you know, when we started, someone had to then decide to show your film. Like, we shared this distributor, like this tiny distributor in Toronto for, you know, called Cinephile, and that was the first guy, Andre Bennett, who decided that our film should then be seen in a theater. Well, that seems so quaint now. I mean, you know, you could just, you know, download and anyone in the world can see your movie. So that's, you can't minimize the nature of that revolution. It's huge, you know, that you can shoot the stuff and you can distribute it. So the question then is, well, how does it get attention? And hopefully it's because the story is so good.
and hopefully because it's doing something new to the form. But the sheer act of making a film is not so special in and of itself. You know, it used to be that you would see a feature and you would go, oh, it had to have passed a number of rungs in order to get to that point, so it's been vetted by a number of other people. Well, not the case anymore. You know, and I think the real heroes are the festival programmers. I don't know how they, you know, there's so much stuff to get through. And how do they do that job? I mean, once it gets to a festival, you assume that it's gonna be okay. But, and then there's so many more festivals. So it's a different world, but I don't think it's a world that different from, you know, the worlds that novelists and musicians and visual artists have been navigating for eons. For
centuries. I'm always excited by that analogy that, you know, basement bands could make music cheaply and get out. And for a while there was really, in the late 70s, early 80s, it was really fashionable for basement bands to get out there, independent labels, then later Sub Pop and the grunge period. And so I was sort of hoping that somehow the basement band equivalent of filmmakers would really make an impact. And the film industry does sort of move a little more slowly than all the other art forms. Music is always instantaneous and changes quickly with trends. I'm sort of hoping, it's a dream of mine that, although it'll create a lot of jealousy in me, that the fact that movies can be made cheaply now, that cinema's Rimbaud, maybe some really young genius, no longer held back by just the sheer cost of filmmaking, will just be free to create something and it'll be really beautiful and change film history forever. I'm still kind of hoping that'll happen. I will spontaneously combust with jealousy if it does.
I mean, but the other thing too is that, I mean, like, why are we talking about features? Like, features are the product of, like, this theatrical invention that's
changing.
That you had to have two screenings, one at 7, one at around 9. But that's also becoming kind of
and short films and documentaries.
You know, because of the internet, because of the way we're downloading films, that really, you know, I think short films or medium length films or, you know, the length of the project, it will seem to become a little bit, you know, ridiculous. I mean, blockbusters will still need to fit into those increasingly diminished screen spaces because there's far fewer theaters. I mean, like, look at, like, if you want to have a film opening in Upper West Side, you know, Manhattan, like it's just very limited. Like, you have very few screens.
Yeah.
And so that seems to suggest that we're not going to be talking about features in 10 years.
That's
like, as independent filmmakers, like, why are we still talking about feature length? It's a holdover from a theatrical distribution system that is no longer working for anyone.
Just to be devil's advocate, but couldn't you say that there are commercial reasons for why one has prescribed lengths, but at the same time that perhaps certain stories gravitate towards being told over the course of 90 minutes to 2 hours?
Sure, but I'm not saying that won't happen, but it also means that, you know, if it ends up being, right now when you make a feature film, you sign a contract that says it's going to be between 90 minutes and what, 110 usually, maybe 85 to 110, but that's going to seem ridiculous because those films are not being released theatrically. They're being released on VOD or day, you know, like it's
they
other
could be
systems.
40 minutes.
They could be 40 minutes.
Like
and
a novella instead of a fatty, you know.
Right, yeah. You know, so, and I also think, you know, that yes, I mean, there is, let's say, a writer decides to write a short story or a novel, and that maybe, yes, it's true that the feature film is more akin to the short story and that the TV series is more akin to like a novel, and that those are, you know, if you are a novelist, you'll gravitate towards, you know, a series or a multi-part. But I'm also saying that if you have an idea, like My Winnipeg, I mean, that doesn't have to be a feature. It can be like 55 minutes or it could be 62, and that won't inhibit its release.
Yeah.
I mean, that's going to happen 100%. Like, there's no question in 10 years that's, this whole conversation will seem quaint because it would have already happened. I can see it now. And that's great for people who want to work in the short or the medium length form, which is something unto itself, you know.
Yes, is there? Over here? Yes, please.
Okay, so you're talking about the fact that everything that we know now is going to become history. So let's ask a history question. Okay, accepting each other, would you each tell me who you think the best Canadian filmmaker in history would be?
In history?
history.
You can just give me your favorite one. That would do too.
I would say that there's no question personally that I think that Claude Jutra and David Cronenberg are two people that I would hold in very high esteem, and who have had a strong influence on my work. And actually, when I was talking about the tax shelter years as being a write-off, well, that's actually some of David's finest work was done through the tax shelter system.
Yeah.
So those are two filmmakers that I hold in very high esteem. There's a lot of other people, but those are senior filmmakers that I think about.
Yeah, the answer would just be David Cronenberg for me, I guess. You know, but I don't really like doing this. I was given a ballot. The Toronto Film Festival gave a top 10
right.
films.
Yeah.
Thing, but I'm too lazy to read the fine print, and I just wrote in the ballot, not realizing that the ballots would be made public. And it's dangerous when you're a filmmaker and you're suddenly ranking each other. I had a brief film reviewing career, and I gave a wonderful Canadian filmmaker, Deepa Mehta, a mixed review. I don't know what I was thinking about. I had started my little journalism career writing about dead filmmakers. Films from the past that I really liked, and all of a sudden this thing came across my desk to review, and I gave it kind of a mixed review, and all of a sudden I'm going, wait a minute, she's I sit at the same dinner table with her at film festivals and things, so I'm an idiot. And she just killed me with kindness after that, if she read it. I think she did, because she just got even nicer whenever she saw me, and just nicer and nicer. She invited me over to her place for dinner, and I was like, oh my God, stop it, Deepa. I almost don't feel like answering it, but David for sure, and I'm not gonna rank any other ones. Mm-hmm. His body of work is so huge. I think I did put an Atom Egoyan film on my ballot.
Oh, that's nice of you, yeah.
But you were probably smart enough not to vote, though.
I didn't vote on
that. See, you always do. I'm sick of not being Atom Egoyan. Always doing the right thing.
Oh, there's individual, like there's some, like I do think, I don't know if you've seen Atanasarat, fantastic.
That's right.
That's an extraordinary film. I mean, I find it kind of interesting that you know, that there are three founding nations in the country, obviously, and that, you know, there are, you know, we're lucky that each of them are represented by, you know, like really quite extraordinary films, you know. And he's... Yes, a great, great film.
Yeah.
Great film.
Okay, well, I want to thank both of our directors for this.
Thank you. I can never think of, when people ask me my favorite anything, I can never think of single title. I did make Zacharias' film my favorite.
And you still have the chance to see Guy's film as the closing night film tomorrow night.
I know that film very well.
Do you know
but
what he's
I didn't.
Reading?
But
you know what magazine is?
No.
It's